Nobody noticed I had the wrong glasses, did they? Good morning, everybody. Right, a couple of things this morning then. Now, the rota for the multimedia at the back, we do need another volunteer on that rota. Obviously, more than one would be great. So if anybody feels this is something they could do, you could either see Roger. I'm not sure, is Roger here today? Oh, there's Roger. Sorry. I need the other glasses now, Roger. Or me. Okay. It's not the cameras, no. It's just this bit up here. It's just, I could say it's just pressing a button, but I'm sure it isn't. No. Right, crosstalk's going to be a little bit late this week, so just bear with the team. They're doing everything they can, but sometimes unforeseen circumstances pop up, as you all know, and these things happen. Church meetings next Sunday at 12 o'clock. I've got 3 birthdays. I've got Emily Kirk. Emily?
It's Emily Wright.
Oh, it's Emily Wright, sorry. Oh, sorry. And she's 18. I know. Can't believe that. Sue Thomason. And I know he's here, Simon Willis. It's next Sunday. Actually, we should do you on Sunday next week, shouldn't we? No, I'm taking him back out. Okay, then. Perhaps we can sing Happy Birthday, please, John. Oh, God bless you. Pleasure to welcome Sharon.
Thank you, Elizabeth. It doesn't seem right to call it another notice because that sort of makes it, trivializes it, but just something else, that some news that some of you I expect have already heard, but just to say our beloved sister Elsie Hicks has died. Her funeral service will be on the 16th of February at 10:30 a.m. But I see here it says at Finch Hampstead Creme, the East Hampstead Creme. So there'll no doubt be something more in the notices about that. But I know that Sue will remember her in our prayers later. So, risen in glory, as we say. Our call to worship has a response. I believe it's going to appear on the screen. Hopefully, maybe. No? Don't worry. I will just say it as a call to worship. And at the end, you can respond with amen. Healing God, we come to praise you. Life-giving God, we come to hear and receive. Oh, there we are. Your whole. Let's start that again, because now you have got a space. Healing God, we come to praise you. Life-giving God, we come to hear and receive your holy word. Transforming God, we come to you, knowing our need for transformation. As we gather to worship in God's name, may the Lord be with each one of us. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord our God, as we come before you now in praise and worship, may the thoughts of our minds and the words of our mouths be pleasing to you. May there be in our hearts an openness to your spirit and a willingness to receive your love. Open our ears to hear your word and the message you would bring to us. Amen. Amen. And we're going to sing our first hymn. If you're following in hymn books at all, it's Songs of Fellowship 597, When Morning Gilds the Skies. Thank you, John. Mm-hmm. please be seated. And Glynis is going to come now and bring to us our Old Testament reading. Thank you, Glynis.
Our Old Testament reading is from Deuteronomy, reading from chapter 18, verses 15 to 20. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own brothers. You must listen to him, for this is what you asked of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly, when you said, "Let us not hear the voice of the Lord our God, nor see this great fire any more, or else we will die." The Lord said to me, "What they say is good. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers. I will put my words in his mouth, and he will tell them everything I command him. If any prophet speaks in my name, I myself will call him to account." If anyone does not listen to his words, the prophet speaks in my name, I will call him to account. But a prophet who presumes to speak in my name anything I have not commanded him to say, or a prophet who speaks in the name of other gods, must be put to death. Amen. May God add his blessing to that reading. Precarious.
Yeah, I know. It's okay, it's still there. That's really good. That passage, those were the words of Moses. And he was talking about the fact that others would be called to lead, others would be called to speak. And whereas people knew Moses and they'd built up trust with him, new people, well, it would be a bit more difficult, wouldn't it? And so Moses speaks into that and says, you've got to look out for the prophets that will speak with the authority and truth of God, and those who won't. And as you heard, some dire consequences for any prophet that came forward and spoke words that weren't given to them by God. But it made me think about the fact that we live in an age, don't we, where there is fake news, where we have AI, we have chatbot. I believe, I haven't done it, I hope you believe me on this, but I believe I could have put in the theme of today's sermon and let it write it for me. Maybe it would have been better, only, you know, how will you ever know? But it's very easy to get away with dishonesty. And I don't know, does anybody here watch Would I Lie to You? Yeah. It's great fun, isn't it? It's great fun. Well, I thought this morning, we can't emulate it exactly, because in Would I Lie to You, the contestants actually make a statement that could be true or it could be a lie, and the others are able to quiz them. We don't really have that opportunity for you to quiz us, but Mike is going to come up as well. Come on, Mike. And he and I are going to share some statements with you. And each one of us has three statements. And so we're going to do A, B, and C. And at the end of them, we'll do one of us at a time, I think. At the end of them, I want you to vote on what you think was the lie. So two of the statements will be true, and one will be a lie. Do you want to go first?
Yeah, you better say what our relationship is, people who don't know.
This is my husband. Okay. For those who don't know. Do you want to do yours first?
Yes, I'll start.
Hang on. I guess I just realised you're going to need a microphone. I know you've got a loud voice, but...
That comes with living with you.
Okay.
Okay. My first love is football, and I'm a massive fan of Tottenham Hotspur. In fact, I used to live very close to the football ground.
Okay, so that's his first statement. Okay, we won't vote till you've done all three. Okay.
I have a little hobby. It's the Napoleonic era of history, and I paint little soldiers, and I've got over 22,000 painted at the moment. And the third statement is, when I was younger, I was often told that I looked like Noel Edmonds.
Okay, right. So two of those statements are true, one is a lie. So the first statement is that Mike's first love in football was Tottenham Hotspur, that's A. B, that he's painted over 22,000 model soldiers, which is actually more than there were in the Napoleonic War, I believe. And the third one is when he was younger, he was often told he looked like Noel Edmonds. So, if you think the first statement, the football club one, is a lie, put up your hands. Oh, I think you're better known than you might have thought you were. Okay, second one. You're very interested. You've painted over 22,000 soldiers. If you think that's a lie, put up your hands. Oh, okay, right. And the third one is when he was younger, he was often mistaken for Noel Edmonds. Okay, well, Mike, which of those is a lie?
The Tottenham Hotspur one's a lie. Watford is my football club, and indeed I did used to live very close to the ground.
Thank you. There we go. Thank you very much. So, you were more or less evenly divided, I think. Actually, although you laughed, there were less people who thought, or fewer people, thought that Mike might have looked like Noel Edmonds. It's at this point I really wish I thought in advance to ask Mike and had brought a photo of him that could have gone up on the screen. Because he really did look like Noel Edmonds. He had masses of red hair, and if you'd seen him, you'd have gone, I can see why they said that. So, okay, you were divided. I'm guessing those who know about his love for painting soldiers were only probably surprised by the number of soldiers painted. But if you don't have any knowledge of a person, though, it can be quite hard to know, is it truth or lie? So here are three of mine, okay? First one, when I was 10 years old, I ran away from home. Second one, when I was a young woman, I was arrested for a breach of the peace at a CND rally. And the third one, I met Mike on a blind date, and the first thing he did was offer me a radish to eat. Okay. So, A, if you think this is a lie, put up your hand. I ran away from home when I was 10. Okay, not that many hands. Number two, or B, when I was a young woman, I was arrested for breach of the peace at a CND rally. You want that to be true? It looks like you're in the majority. Most people seem to think that could be the true, because there's not many hands. And C, I met Mike on a blind date, and the first thing he did was offer me a radish to eat. All I can say is you don't know Mike. I really did meet him on a blind date, and the first thing he did really was offer me a radish to eat. And yet, here we are. The lie among those, I'm afraid, is I was never arrested. I'm sure there might be time to come, but that was it. So I'm not sure if it's good it seems like I was a better liar than Mike. It's probably not really, is it? But it's perhaps what you can believe about a person. But as we go on into the service, we're going to be thinking about what is it that makes it possible to tell if a person speaks the truth, and in particular in terms of following them as Christians, or, you know, being helped by them, our leaders, whatever, that they have God's authority. So we'll be thinking about that as we go along. We are going to sing now number 194 in Songs of Fellowship, How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds. Thank you. Is now going to bring us our gospel reading. Thank you.
Our gospel reading comes from the Gospel of Mark, reading in chapter 1 from verses 21 to 28, and it's subtitled Jesus Drives Out an Evil Spirit. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, Jesus went into the synagogue and began to teach. The people were amazed at his teaching, because he taught them as one who had authority, not as the teachers of the law. Just then, a man in their synagogue who was possessed by an evil spirit cried out, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." "Be quiet," said Jesus sternly. "Come out of him." The evil spirit shook the man violently and came out of him with a shriek. The people were all so amazed that they asked each other, "What is this? A new teaching, and with authority. He even gives orders to evil spirits, and they obey him." News about Jesus spread quickly over the whole region of Galilee. May our dear Lord add his blessing to the both those readings from his holy word. Amen.
Thank you, Glynis. So we come now to a time of prayer as we bring to God both our praise and our confession. Let us pray. Lord God, you are amazing. We look around us at this still winter world, stunned by its stark beauty and thrilled by your attention to detail. Though the ground is dark and uninviting, and the trees bear their branches to a grey sky, well, not today, the sun's shining, but we know that secret life is hidden below and within. One day soon, bulbs will thrust through the cold earth, and buds will appear on those naked branches. Green leaves will once again begin to unfurl, and spring will come with the promise of new life. Lord God, we thank you that in the midst of winter, spring bides its time, that in the midst of death, new life waits to blossom forth. Soon, very soon, the unseen and unspoken signal will be given. And in the garden, a stone will be rolled away from an empty tomb, and your eternal promise will be fulfilled. Creation will proclaim your glory, and our hearts will echo its praise. New life in Christ, everlasting and wonderful. Truly, Lord God, you are amazing, and we praise and adore you. Amen. And our prayer of confession. What is it that the Lord asks of us? Only this, that we act justly, that we love tenderly, and that we walk humbly with our God. For the times that we have failed to act justly, we ask your forgiveness and mercy. For the times we have failed to love tenderly, we ask your forgiveness and mercy. For the times we have failed to walk humbly with you, we ask your forgiveness and mercy. Here is the good news. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on eagle's wings. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. So hear the Lord's promise to us. Our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. We're going to sing again, number 1381, sung in Songs of Fellowship, Jesus Christ is Waiting.
Thank you.
Please be seated. I think that's a lovely modern hymn, isn't it? Wonderful words and a haunting tune. Really lovely. In our New Testament reading today, what we're having is the direct follow-on from last week, where Jesus called his disciples. And so this is right at the beginning of Mark's gospel. Mark doesn't waste time on any unnecessary words or any elaboration. He's like, boom, 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 boom. And so we don't have a nativity or a birth story in Mark. His starts with Jesus coming for baptism and then going off into the wilderness and being prepared for ministry. And then Jesus comes and he calls his first disciples. And this is the first thing that happens that's recorded after that. And his starting place is Capernaum. It's the Sabbath day. And Jesus goes to the synagogue, very natural thing as a Jewish man for him to do. And he begins to teach. Now, in Mark's gospel, because it's very much boom, 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 he packs a lot of meaning into just a few verses. And it probably will help us to understand a little bit more of the significance of this morning's reading if we understand a bit more about what happens at the synagogue, or certainly what happened in Jesus' day. The synagogue was central to the Jewish community. It was really an important part of their lives. And wherever there was a community of 10 or more Jewish families, it was decreed by law that there should be a synagogue, which was the center for teaching and instruction. But the services at the synagogue were very different from what we experience today. They consisted of just three elements: prayer, the reading of the Holy Scriptures, and an exposition and teaching on the passage that had been read. And there was no permanent preacher or teacher appointed. Instead, the leader of the synagogue could choose any one of the men present to come and speak about the passage. And because all the young men had been trained in the Holy Scriptures, this was not as frightening as it might be if, you know, if Mike next week says, well, I'm not going to preach, I'm just going to pick on one of you. So they came, perhaps these would have been passages they would have examined at depth. It wasn't such a startling thing that they should ask Jesus, but nevertheless, it was an honor. What was a surprise, or a shock even, was how he spoke. Because Mark reports that he didn't speak or preach as the scribes did. Now, the task of the scribes was to transmit and teach the Mosaic law and the many regulations that had developed from it. And not all of those were written down. We've got the Ten Commandments, but there were other laws, some of which were written down, but some of which were passed on as oral law. And they were taught by every new generation of scribes and committed to memory. I don't know, somebody remarked to me the other day, it might be a bit of a sweeping generalization, but they remarked that young people these days often don't have the good memories that their elders have. And this is because, and I'm prepared to be called out on this, by the way, but it's because they can find out everything just by looking at their phone. They don't need to remember. And you can't easily, unless you've got that kind of brain, you can't easily remember phone numbers anymore, can you? But I bet you, if I asked you, what was the phone number you had, your first phone number in your when you were growing up, you'd know it. Who here can remember their telephone number from? Okay. Who? Yeah, excellent. Who can remember the first car they had, its number plate? Who struggles to remember their existing car's number plate? But we do. We used to commit so much more to memory than we have to do now. back in that day, this was the traditional way of learning, not just in Judaism, but in many, many cultures. Information was passed on by being told. We remember stories better than sets of facts, don't we? And stories would be told and retold with actually surprising accuracy. And what would happen is that when somebody would start to teach on one of the passages from the Hebrew scriptures, they would always, always reference a previous person of authority, maybe a rabbi, and they would say, as Rabbi so-and-so taught, so we know, and they would recite what it was that had been learnt by that from that rabbi. And in a way, that's not so dissimilar to our law courts, is it? Judges are very reluctant to set a precedent simply because it can then be challenged. It doesn't mean they don't ever do it, obviously they do, but more often than not, if they can, they will choose something that's already been upheld in law, because then the precedent has already been set and they know that it's good, it's solid. And so in the same way, somebody would stand up and say, as so-and-so has said, so we know this, or we understand that, or we believe the other. The difference when Jesus started to teach was that he didn't reference other rabbis. He didn't speak about other teachers. He spoke as one with personal authority, the authority that was God-given. Maybe it's worth us just pausing for a moment to think about the difference between power and authority. Now, power can be given to a person by dint of the position they hold, but authority is something that comes from within. I'm sure you can all think back to people that you have known or maybe know now who have a natural authority about them. And I'm going to give you a story or tell you a story that illustrates that. Do you remember the tragedy of the sinking of the Herald of Free Enterprise, the ferry? Yeah, I'm sure most of you will. You might be surprised to remember or to recall, as actually as long ago as 1987. But the news of it kind of grabbed us all, didn't it? Because the horror of it was that it happened, the sinking of it happened so quickly. It was the 6th of March, and the ferry went out from the Belgian port of Zeebrugge, and it sank within 90 seconds. What had happened, a minute and a half. If we had a fire drill now, we would not expect everybody to have been able to exit the church in a minute and a half, although probably within three. I'm not quite sure what the expectation is. But in a minute and a half, that's all it took for that ferry to sink. And if you remember why, it was because somebody had forgotten to close the bow doors. And the water just swept in. And the design of ferries is not, it's not like a liner, it's not like a ship cruise or anything like that. It is tank-like, isn't it? And once that car deck was covered with water, the sheer weight just brought it down. Well, in the chaos and panic, there were several people who acted heroically and with a natural authority, and what they did saved lives. So I'm going to mention two here. One of them was a 6'3" bank employee, Andrew Parker, and he made himself into a human bridge so that others could clamber over him to safety. He survived and was later awarded the George Medal for acts of great bravery. The other one was a head waiter on the ferry, and his name was Michael Skippin. And his clear thinking and sacrificial actions saved many of those who were trapped in the restaurant as he helped them to reach the broken windows from which he could help them up to the surface and to others who were waiting to rescue them. He was a 30-year-old man, and he was actually a very strong swimmer. And there were many opportunities as he rescued others to have stopped and still be alive today, but he didn't. He kept going back as long as there were people there, and sadly, in the end, he drowned, and he was awarded the George Medal posthumously. But what drew people to these two men, and through them to rescue, was not because they held any position of power. Andrew Parker wasn't even an employee on the ferry. He had no uniform. There was nothing that would, apart from being 6'3", there was nothing that would mark him out from being different from any other person around him. And although Michael Skippen did work there, he was simply a waiter, a head waiter. But neither one of them, through their position of authority, through their position of power, was able to help. But they had a natural authority. And then, of course, once people could see what was happening, everyone who was near to them made use of what they were offering. When Jesus spoke with authority, no doubt many of the people present were reminded of the Old Testament passage where Moses says, "Others will come and others will lead you." But not everybody who prophesies will be a person of truth. Not everybody who speaks will be bringing you God's word. And you need to know and to discern who are the truth speakers and who are not. And clearly there was something there with Jesus that meant they thought, this is a man who has come from God. But, of course, there are over the years, and always were, many false prophets. And how would they know if a true prophet was actually among them? Well, the scriptures say that the accuracy of any prophecy is spoken both by how it is borne out, but also by how the words and actions of the person speaking it reflect what they are saying. So it's the old thing, isn't it? You can't get good fruit from a tree that's diseased. In the same way, anybody could say anything and they could make a prophecy or they could speak words that they wanted other people to believe. And it might be a very attractive thing. But if in their own life, what they're showing are lies, deceit, bearing false witness, maybe acts of criminality, and then they say, but, you know, I'm suitable to hold a position of great authority and the power in this country or in another country like America or wherever, their acts can call them out. And so it's no coincidence whatsoever, but a God-given thing that having just spoken, Jesus is confronted with a man who is considered to be demon-possessed. In our present day, we might quibble about whether the person was demon-possessed or whether they had some kind of mental or physical illness. It could perhaps have been schizophrenic, or maybe they were suffering from epilepsy. But actually, they could have been demon-possessed. And in a way, it doesn't matter, because everybody present believed them to be that man to be demon-possessed, and he himself believed it. And so it was important what Jesus said, because what he said was he addressed those demons, he addressed what was going on in that man, and he just said, be quiet, go from him. And there were a lot of people in that time who claimed to be exorcists, and they had elaborate rites and rituals, probably all the more so in order to convince people and the sufferer that what they're doing was going to be potent, it was going to work, But Jesus didn't need that because he had a God-given power and he had authority. And so the demons, whatever, the illness, left the man and he was restored. So Jesus has spoken with an authority they've not heard of before, and now they've witnessed that authority in action. All Jesus said was, "Be quiet and come out of him." He didn't need to do a whole lot of fancy things, and that was sufficient. But I wonder what this has to say to us this morning. Does our church of today speak with the authority of God? Do its actions back up its words? Remember what I just said about we can say things, people can say things, but if their lives say, actually, I'm clearly not that kind of person, then we've not got authority. We may say things, but we have no authority. What does the church say, and what liberating words do we speak on the things that bind others? If that man was bound through his illness or demon possession, and Jesus broke those bonds, what bonds do we speak out again? What bonds do we help break? And these are some of the things that we should be involved in breaking. Human trafficking in all its forms. Drug and alcohol addiction. Poverty, that's a big one. Poverty absolutely binds people. What can we do to break that bond? What can we do or say to break the bonds of fear, anxiety, and depression? What about homelessness? What do we do to help break the bond of mental illness and the stigma that is attached to it, even now? What do we do? What words do we speak? What actions do we do to break the bond of discrimination, whether that be racial, sexual, or other? And this one, at the moment, looking on a global scale, is so relevant. What words do we as a church speak out, and what actions can we do as a church or individually that help break the bonds of cruelty and injustice and oppression in all its forms? Gosh, it's a big thing, isn't it? And we're only individuals until we come together, and then we're something more. But even so, we're one church among many. But what if every church was really moved to make a difference? Was really moved not just to say, this is what we believe, these are the words we hear read on a Sunday, these are the hymns we sing with all their wonderful words. What if we said, actually, we're going to make a difference? You know, I said at the beginning that I really like that hymn, Jesus Christ is Waiting. And I hope you did too. And I hope the words stirred you. But it's easy to sing and to pay lip service. How can we have the authority of God to change things? Maybe it starts in our own secret or hidden places of prayer. It's not just about when we come together, that's important, but maybe these things start when we take our worries about our friends, our worries about our community, our concerns about the whole world, and we take them to God and we say, God, how can I make a difference? And then when we come together and we do the same thing and we ask God, what can we do? Will you give us the power and authority to be able to speak and to act in your name? In just a moment, we're going to sing Spirit of the Living God. And when we sing that, I'm going to invite us to stay seated. And you may find you don't even need to look at the words. You may find they're imprinted already in your memories. But whether you look up at the screen or down at your hands, I invite you to sing them prayerfully. Because one thing is absolutely for sure. We can't do any of it in our own strength. We can only do it with the strength and the power and the authority of the Holy Spirit. But be aware as we sing it. Look what it says. It says about breaking us, melting us, molding us, filling us. We like the filling bit, but we've got to start off with the breaking and the melting. So be prepared. If you sing that seriously as a prayer, that God might just answer it. I hope he does, because I think that together, in his Holy Spirit, we can speak and act, and what we do can make a big, big difference. So please stay seated, and we're going to sing it through twice. Thank you.
Let's just begin with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Some weeks before Christmas, I started to think about the subject of today's prayer. And I looked it up and saw that it was the fourth week, fourth Sunday of Epiphany. So I checked out Epiphany, and biblically it's about the Magi travelling to see the newborn child. As we realise, he wasn't newborn probably by the time they got there, but it's the Gentile introduction to the Jewish Messiah. In
everyday parlance, we tend to use the word epiphany as a sudden realization, a breakthrough. It all seemed very complicated anyway, so I thought, well, even with the help of the Holy Spirit, I was struggling a bit, so I thought I'll leave it till after Christmas. As most of you know, over the Christmas period, I lost my mum. And it was a horrible, sad, wretched time. But after it, I had a bit of an epiphany because I realised just how close the light of Jesus had been in the whole horrible affair. Jesus's light was in the paramedics who first came to Mum. She'd got through her 101st birthday on Boxing Day, and she took ill the day after. And they came to her, and she's very stubborn. She didn't want to go to hospital, but they were so kind. Jesus shone through them. He shone through the top consultant surgeon who thought that even at 101, she deserved a crack at an operation to try and save her. And he came in at midnight to do this emergency operation. His chief anaesthetist stayed after his going home time at 6 o'clock to accompany him in the operation. Jesus shining. He shone through the people in the recovery the next day when they told us that Mum wouldn't make it. But they were so kind to us. They made us a little area. They couldn't move her for a while, but they made us a special curtained off area where the family could be with Mum. Jesus shone through the staff in F7. Incredible. She was there for 4 days, unconscious, but they treated her with such dignity and love. And even he shone through the lady in the paper shop, because I went down and said, have you got any Gaviscon? And she said, I'll look for you. And she found me some indigestion tablets, which was wonderful. All these little things that are actually huge things when Jesus is shining. So there was my title for today, Light in the Darkness. Let us pray. Dearest Father, ever faithful Lord, precious Holy Spirit, thank you for your light. Psalm 18 tells us, you, Lord, keep my lamp burning. My God turns my darkness into light. So we thank you, Father, for the sun, the moon, and the stars, our natural source of light, present from the beginning of our world. But we thank you, too, for the invention of electricity, how we take for granted the little switch that turns our darkness into day, and how nervous are we when something goes wrong. So we thank you for the electricians who help us out. We thank you for all the services, the people who provide our gas, water, sewage disposal, broadband, people who climb poles and dig holes in the worst of weather to make our lives more comfortable. We pray for the light of the NHS, from the consultants to the cleaners, people who work so hard, often with little thanks, fixing us when we're sick, comforting us when they can't. Dear Lord, we pray for charities and volunteers around the world. There are countless people holding out a hand, a beam of light, to those who suffer. We pray for those who visit the sick, help the homeless, hug the lonely. We pray for those who can sense when a smile or a brief conversation would brighten someone's day. As Christians, we should notice when darkness can be penetrated by the love we have from you, by shining your light through our manner, actions, and words of encouragement. Dear Lord, when we think of the persecuted church, we hear the words from Psalm 27. The Lord is my light, whom shall I fear? We pray for people like Saleh, a Yemeni man who runs a secret church, who, despite the terrible danger, shines a light amongst the believers. He says, "My dreams go further. I pray to see the church spread into all of Africa and the rest of the Arabian Peninsula." We pray for others like him whose strong Christian bravery can barely be comprehended. Finally, Lord, we pray for ourselves. So many of us have times when the darkness feels overwhelming. Please help us not to fear. In John 1, you say, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." Words to remember. So in a few moments of silence, let us pray into that darkness. Let us look up like the Magi and see that your light is there. All is well. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Amen.
Thank you, Sue, and thank you for the prayerful and the time you gave to preparing that. We're going to sing our final hymn now, Songs of Fellowship 307, Jesus, the name high over all. You may not be aware of this, but that hymn originally had 22 verses. I feel that God wanted us to take in some of those words a little bit more this morning, so praise him for that. And our blessing. May the peace of God pervade you in mind and soul with his serenity. May the joy of God fill you to overflowing, that others may be gladdened by it also. And may the hope of God never leave you, but keep you steadfast in all you do. May the love of God burn in your hearts to warm the lives of all whom you meet, today, tomorrow, and every day. Amen.